And I relived every death that was on my hands. I killed the women and children. I lamented those things. I didn't mean to, but they happened. Well, let's see if we can get in. Nobody ever goes in here. I think they're all afraid I got it booby trapped or something.
Εκ πρώτης όψεως, το σπίτι του Bo Greitz δεν διαφέρει σε τίποτα από το σπίτι μιας συνηθισμένης αμερικανικής οικογένειας. Ο Bo όμως δεν είναι ένας συνηθισμένος Αμερικανός και στην πραγματικότητα το σπίτι του κάθε άλλο παρά συνηθισμένο είναι. Στην αυλή, δίπλα στα αυτοκίνητα για τη μηχανή του, παρκάρει το ιδιωτικό αεροπλάνο του. Σε κάθε δωμάτιο του σπιτιού, ακόμη και στην τουαλέτα, κρύβει ένα όπλο.
Why do you have so many guns in the house?
Makes me feel better. It just does. I feel I've always had them around, and I've raised four children. Nobody's ever been shot accidentally. All I ever wanted to be was a soldier. And so God graced me, not just to be a soldier, but to be part of the elite in America, the special forces.
Ο συνταγματάρχης εν αποστρατεία, Bo Greitz, είναι ο πιο παρασημοφορημένος στρατιωτικός των Αμερικανικών Ειδικών Δυνάμεων. Ξεκίνησε τη συλλογή του από παράσημα στον πόλεμο του Βιετνάμ. Ήταν το πρωτοπαλίκαρο του διοικητή του Αμερικανικού στρατού.
I ran an assassination unit. But I'm proud to say that my assassins were primarily women. And we had, women are much more loyal than men. Women don't have egos. Women, as long as you keep them happy, will not betray you. One I'll never forget was a little mousy Vietnamese girl who used Gillette razor blades. If you remember, the old razor blade had just one edge. And so her weapon of choice was these six razor blades. She'd put three in between each finger when she had her agent in a compromised position, and then just climb up on top of him and just stroke his, just one stroke. And he never knew there was no real pain, but he instantly bled out.
How many people did your units?
All my units killed hundreds. Hundreds.
Η μονάδα του, ένα τάγμα θανάτου στα βάθη της ζούγκλας, είχε τον κωδικό Β36. Την αποτελούσαν Καμποτζιανοί και Κινέζοι μισθοφόροι, άνδρες και γυναίκες δολοφόνοι.
When we ambushed, for example, we had to kill everybody. But the Cambodians, it was hard keeping prisoners because they wanted to kill everything they found. And if I needed prisoners, I've had them open fire over another sector to draw my attention while they executed the Vietnamese prisoners that we had, and then they'd say, that's why I love them, that's why they were perfect. Because they would rape, burn, pillage, murder, without any, and then just sit there and eat a bowl of rice. So a lot of those things, I didn't like them happening. Babies, you know, seeing them with half their skull gone. You don't mean to, but I found out something. The innocent suffer, so the guilty can be punished someday.
Οι φίλοι του τον φωνάζουν Ράμπο. Λένε ότι η ζωή και τα κατορθώματά του ενέπνευσαν τους δημιουργούς και των τριών ταινιών. Ο ίδιος το αποδίδει στον Francis Ford Coppola και σε μια άλλη θρύλικη ταινία.
Hollywood has no imagination. They wanted to use the picture in General Westmoreland's book. It shows me kneeling beside Miss Toy with some of the gorillas. They wanted to put Marlon Brando's face over mine for the first movie about Vietnam, Apocalypse Now.
This is the end, beautiful friend.
We didn't do all that bad. I mean, there was some bad stuff. I've caught Cambodians fornicating with dead females that we had brought back when they were still living as prisoners. And there were disgusting things like that.
Ο συνταγματάρχης Γκράιτς είχε αναπτύξει μια ειδική σχέση με το θάνατο. Επέστρεψε από το Βιετνάμ και βρέθηκε σε μυστικές επιχειρήσεις στη Λατινική Αμερική, την Καμπότζη και το Λάος. Πήρε εντολή να σκοτώσει τον στρατηγό Νοριέγκα στον Παναμά. Επέστρεψε στο Βιετνάμ για να αναζητήσει ξεχασμένους Αμερικανούς εχμαλώτους πολέμου. Μια μέρα στράφηκε ενάντια στο ίδιο το σύστημα που υπηρετούσε και επέστρεψε στο σπίτι του στη Νεβάδα. Το Sandy Valley είναι μια μικρή κοινότητα στη μέση του πουθενά, 40 μίλια από το Las Vegas. Ο μοναδικός δρόμος που οδηγεί εδώ περνά μέσα από αυτά τα βουνά. Τα σπίτια είναι χτισμένα δίπλα σε ένα διάδρομο προσγείωσης για μικρά αεροσκάφη. Σε αυτό το σεληνιακό τοπίο της Άγριας Δύσης, ο Γκράιτς εκπαίδευσε 100 Αφγανούς Μουτζαχεντίν για να γυρίσουν στη πατρίδα τους και να πολεμήσουν τους Σοβιετικούς δεκαετία του 80.
This was the place where you trained the Afghan fighters, the Mujahideen fighters.
Yeah, we had, like I say, it was 10-foot razor wire, 100 meters by 100 meters. We had a well up on the hill that provided us with water. We had a command bunker.
Who taught them to fire this Stinger missiles?
Oh, I did.
Ο Μπο μας έφερε στην έρημο για να μας δείξει μερικά από τα όπλα που έχει στο σπίτι.
The gun itself is very... is very easy to manipulate. So you can fire it by the hip. See Osama bin Laden. He has his little bitty AK. So you see, now you know where it comes from. We make little bitty AKs. Anyway, the fireball will touch the ground on this thing. It's pretty interesting. This is 223, the fireball on this one. So at night, I mean, it's really frightening. So it'd be good just from an effect because of the fireball that goes all the way down. You see how loud that is? I got special ammunition in here.
Ο συνταγματάρχης Γκράιτς είναι ένας ανήσυχος Αμερικανός. Το 1992 έθεσε υποψηφιότητα για την Προεδρία των Ηνωμένων Πολιτειών. Συγκέντρωσε γύρω του κάθε λογής ανθρώπους και άρχισε να δημιουργεί ένα μικρό κίνημα. Στο μυαλό του, ο πόλεμος δεν είχε τελειώσει ποτέ. Η ιδέα μιας αόρατης απειλής τον κρατούσε ζωντανό. Θα ανακαλούσε ξανά τις τεχνικές επιβίωσης που του έμαθε ο στρατός για να τις χρησιμοποιήσει με έναν εντελώς διαφορετικό τρόπο.
Survivalism would be like a prisoner of war with no water, no provisions, no map, just out there. But readiness is what I deal in, because that's what most Americans don't want to endure, and most Americans won't be in a survival situation. So readiness means knowing how to handle combat injuries, gunshot wounds, traumatic wounds like compound fractures, arteries that have been severed, serious emergency birthing. These are things.
Στα τέλη του 1995 έθεσε σε εφαρμογή το μεγαλεπίβολο σχέδιό του. Να βρει μια τοποθεσία στην Αμερική και να ζήσει εκεί μαζί με τους συντρόφους του στην τέχνη της επιβίωσης.
When we were driving, as we turned off at Kamiya and started up this about 7-mile drive, I said, good grief, this is awful. Because the Clearwater River, everything was so foggy, you couldn't barely see your hand in front of your face. And just we're driving up that final little rise, we just broke out on top. Here it is, just like this. And here's all this, all the tops of the fog. And I looked out, and I looked up, because I said, God, this is almost like being in heaven. Because you could just see yourself, you walking on the clouds. And so that name just stuck.
Σε αυτούς τους λόφους, στην πολιτεία του Άιντεχο, 1,000 μίλια βόρεια από την έρημο της Νεβάδα, ο Μπο βρήκε το δικό του παράδεισο.
The idea of almost heaven was find the safest place in America, where people could have fertile soil, clear water, clear skies, no threat. From it's not a any kind of targeting area, and so I did find it. When I decided on putting in that community, I talked to the sheriff, and he said, "Bo, we're not going to bother you if you don't bother us."
Carry. You talk about the survivalist and all the stuff we carry.
That's survivalist gear.
Survivalist gear. And as you can tell, because we're so remote, you know, all of us carry weapons. We have shotguns. We all carry long rifles, some fully automatic. I have an M16 in there.
You're loaded.
You know, we all carry that because we are so rural. We don't have backup. When something happens, we have to do it ourselves. We can't wait for somebody else.
How many guns do you have with you, usually?
With me? At least four.
At least four?
Yeah.
Common people, they carry guns in their cars.
Everybody. I could probably look in this parking lot. This is a county parking lot. There's probably weapons in every one of them.
Why these undergovernment groups and these survivalist groups, they prefer Idaho?
The remoteness. Because we're so remote that basically, like you say, we're so rural, a lot of our communities only have, like our one small community of Elk River has 120 people in it. We had one big, large group that moved in the late 80s and early 90s, you know, based on Bogue rights. Was he actually ran for president of the United States years ago. He was real high up in the military, and he came in and he started his own area he called Almost Heaven. They were survivalists. They were basically people that wanted to come up here and live. They bought generators, they had fuel, they had food storage. They have, you know, obviously ways of taking care of themselves if there's a catastrophic event of some sort, either war or something else. What are they afraid of? I think they're afraid of you know, changes in the government. They're afraid of
martial law.
Yeah, maybe world control. And, I think they're against that. They're afraid of losing control. You know, it's like there again. It's that line, that fine line. If they cross the line, they could become dangerous.
Well, I grew up in the mountains of Tennessee, which is a very rural area where I lived. I worked security out at Edwards Air Force Base for a number of years. Worked as a bouncer for a number of years, bodyguard, diamond courier. Did some work as an actor now and then. To me, survivalism is just that, survival. I don't like the word ism. An ism is something that's an extreme. To me, it's the ability to clothe myself, find food, build shelter, anything that it takes to survive a catastrophe.
Ο Μπράιαν ζει κοντά στην κοινότητα που ίδρυσε ο Bogue Rights. Μοιράζεται το σπίτι με τον πατέρα του και τον καλύτερο φίλο του, τον Ματ. Έναν πρώην πεζοναύτη.
The connotations that survival, being called a survivalist, that's anymore, that's got connotations of trying to overthrow the government, a gun-toting nut job that wants to blow everything up. That's not survivalism, that's terrorism. And two entirely different things.
Well, that's an M16.
This is an M16, correct.
What about this one?
Okay, this is a 30-06, primarily just used for hunting deer. You know, if you're afraid of guns, then don't own them.
What is the first gun you take with you when you go out in such, in one case like that?
I personally would suggest a 12-gauge.
Yes,
shotgun.
I was just, yes. A shotgun is probably the most universal weapon available. And that would be my first choice, yes.
It's good for hunting, yes. And it's good for defense.
Yes. Second would be any kind of sidearm.
What do you have here?
This is a lot of our supplies. Not all of, but it's a lot of our supplies. We have packs and pack frames, food stores. These boxes are seriously packed and inventoried, but it's all full of survival gear.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, camping gear.
Disaster can also be man-made, so you gotta be prepared for that too.
What would be a man-made catastrophe for you?
The intentional bombing of an area, being attacked from the outside or from within.
Are you afraid of the government imposing martial law in this country?
I would say so, yes. All the signs are there. All the executive orders have been signed. They don't need a search warrant to come into your home anymore. They don't need a search warrant to arrest you. They don't have to have any charges they can prove. They just have to think you might, possibly, at some point in time, could do something.
Are you ready to give up your weapons, your guns, because the government's going to ask you to do so?
No.
Why?
We have a right in this country called the Second Amendment to the Bill of Rights. It says the right of the people to keep and bear arms shall not be infringed. We have the right to defend ourselves. We have the right to be armed. Fear of government, the fear is an armed population. If your government's afraid of you to have guns, then there's something wrong. So we have the right to keep and bear arms. I'm willing to fight and die for that, right? Yes.
Ο Μπράιαν και οι όμοιοι του δεν ενδιαφέρονται μόνο για την επιβίωση και το δικαίωμά τους να έχουν όπλα. Εμφανίζονται ως υπερασπιστές του Αμερικανικού Συντάγματος. Οι κοινότητές τους έχουν απασχολήσει και εξακολουθούν να απασχολούν τις Αμερικανικές Αρχές.
This paper was given to the Phoenix Police Department and given to every other police department in the United States, as far as I know. And it says, if you encounter any of the following, call the Joint Terrorism Task Force. And it gives you the phone number for the Phoenix branch of the FBI. And what's considered terrorist in this country, according to the FBI, was what they call right-wing extremists. Defenders of the U.S. Constitution against federal government and the U.N. super patriots. Groups of individuals engaged in paramilitary training. Well, anybody that believes in the Constitution is what they call a terrorist.
Do you find yourself in this paper?
Some parts of it, yes.
So according to the FBI, you are a domestic terrorist?
I would be considered a domestic terrorist.
But are you a domestic terrorist, or do you believe that you are a domestic terrorist?
I'm probably about as much a terrorist as you are.
Well, everybody's nervous. They know something's coming, and they're right. You know, it's civilization can stop like that. If the electricity is cut off, is destroyed by high winds or something, or a nuclear war, or terrorism, then your civilization is going to come to an absolute halt. There it is. There's my underground house.
Exactly.
Right there.
Underneath, you mean?
Yeah.
Because basically, you can't see a thing. When did you build it, and why?
I built this, in the first part of it in 1971. And Well, because I was living in this little shack on the land, and I was freezing in the shack.
How much did it cost?
The first house cost $50.
$50?
$50. And I lived in that for 4 years, okay? That was back in my hippie years. Now that I'm a yuppie, I want splendor. I want grandeur. So I've spent 10 times as much on the addition in the house. To say, when I moved up here, I had been 6 years in California when I moved up here, and I was expecting then society to collapse. So I still even more expect society to collapse. I mean, it's obvious that the environment is collapsing. I designed this to hold up to 17 people, each of them having their own bunk. And so if things did get bad, if society collapsed, if we were in a terrible war, if there was a nuclear war, or if there was a nuclear winter, so on and so forth, I could put up a whole bunch of people here. Then, unfortunately, we never finished this, and we're losing it. We're losing this house. It's a shame. As you can see, it's deteriorating here. It's beginning to fall apart. Okay, let's go and look at some other rooms. This house here is a shelter house, and we're building this specifically to show people how they can build a house that they can live in, but that they can button down into a shelter that'll take you through almost anything. It'll take you through forest fire, earthquake, explosions, nuclear fallout. No matter what's coming, you should be able to make it in this house. Was with me with the bear.
Ο Μάικ είναι ένας διαφορετικός survivalist. Λιγότερο επικίνδυνος, αλλά το ίδιο γραφικός. And so was that house over there. Το σπίτι του βρίσκεται θαμμένο στα σύνορα του Άινταχο με τον Καναδά. Εδώ και δεκαετίες φαντάζεται τα πιο εφιαλτικά σενάρια και προετοιμάζεται για την κατάρρευση του δυτικού πολιτισμού.
And that could be with the war. I do believe that China is going to invade the United States someday, and they'll do that by knocking out all of our satellites with lasers and jamming all of our computers and everything with the way that they hack all of our computers and stuff, and I think that they're going to quite possibly invade in container cargo ships. They're already sneaking in tens of thousands of Chinese in the cargo containers.
So what's your plan? What are you going to do?
I'm into the Course in Miracles, and it's in the hands of God. If I get my head together right, it's going to make absolutely no difference to me, because this is a dream state, so I have given up worrying about it.
Ο Μάικ είχε αποφασίσει από νωρίς ότι θα αντιμετωπίσει μόνος του το τέλος του κόσμου. Αντίθετα, στην κοινότητα των οπαδών της επιβίωσης που ίδρυσε ο συνταγματάρχης Γκράιτς κοντά στην πολυκάμια του Άινταχο, οι κάτοικοι πολλαπλασιάζουν. Η περιοχή που ονόμασε σχεδόν παράδεισος έφτασε μέσα σε λίγα χρόνια να φιλοξενεί περισσότερες από 350 οικογένειες. Για τον ίδιο τον Γκράιτς όμως, ο παράδεισος εξελίχθηκε σε κόλαση. Μια μέρα η γυναίκα του τον εγκατέλειψε για έναν άλλον άντρα. Ο βετεράνος των ειδικών δυνάμεων, που τραυματίστηκε 3 φορές στα πεδία των μαχών, έβαλε το πιστόλι στην καρδιά και αυτοπυροβολήθηκε. Ο Όταν γλίτωσε το θάνατο για τέταρτη φορά, αποφάσισε να αφήσει πίσω τις άσχημες αναμνήσεις, να εγκαταλείψει το καινούριο του σπίτι στους λόφους του Άινταχο και να επιστρέψει στην έρημο της Νεβάδα. Τη θέση του, στην ηγεσία της κοινότητας των οπαδών της επιβίωσης, θα έπαιρνε ένας εξίσου ανήσυχος Αμερικανός, ο πρώην αστυνομικός Jack McClam.
Survivalism means come as you are and live off the land, you know, and so you need food, you need shelter, and then if we lose this nonviolent redress of our grievances that we're in, you're going to need weapons to protect yourself.
Ο Μακλάμ και οι ομοίοι του ανησυχούν για τα σχέδια της νέας τάξης πραγμάτων. Κατηγορούν τους κομμουνιστές και τους σιωνιστές ότι εξυφαίνουν μια παγκόσμια συνωμοσία. Φοβούνται τη δικτατορία που, όπως πιστεύουν, θα επιβάλλει στον πλανήτη ο Οργανισμός Ηνωμένων Εθνών.
United Nations was set up by communists for the international criminals to feed the world into a totalitarian state, one world government, and that's what it is, and it will be the one world government under the Marxist and communist control. And the president of the UN is not the president of the UN either. The international criminal elite run that organization. You and I'll be slaves. If you don't have $100 billion in the bank or in your control, you're going to be part of the slave. That's the level, $100 billion.
How are you going to react?
I'm going to go to war at that time. We Americans have always believed that there comes a time when you cross a certain line when it's time to fight for our freedoms, you know, and our families.
Are you talking about the guerrilla warfare?
Yes, it'll have to be. It'll have to be.
Γι' αυτό το αλόκοτο κίνημα και όσους συνασπίζονται γύρω από ανθρώπους όπως ο Jack McClam, στην κορυφή της μαύρης λίστας βρίσκεται ο George Bush. Αλλά όχι για την πολιτική.
Very good, Patsy.
Boy George Bush is according to what we've seen in all of our studies, he's a girly man, you know. He's what Arnold Schwarzenegger says is a girly man, and he's listed, if you look at the homosexual websites, he's listed as a homosexual. Sodomy and these type of relationships, man on man and woman on woman, are an abomination, and these people should be killed. Now, the Bible says that. Now we don't kill them today. I've got friends that are homosexual.
Ο Μακλάμ επικαλείται τον Θεό για να δικαιολογήσει τις παρανοϊκές, αν όχι επικίνδυνες αντιλήψεις.
As I read the Bible, God said after he created each of the races in the world, it's good. And in my mind, logically, and in the Bible, if you read the Bible, God said that there should not be intermarriage with the other races. What God has made, man should not be putting together into one. I'm not an extreme right wing. I'm a constitutionalist, and that's not right or left.
Retaliatory weapons are certain to appear.
Welcome back to the Officer Jack McClam program, coming to you from those high rocky mountains of Idaho.
Κάθε απόγευμα ο πρώην αστυνομικός απευθύνεται στους φίλους του μέσω των Ερτζιανών.
Women have to understand that weapons make us powerful against our enemies. Don't forget, use gasoline. It's cheap. It's the poor man's weapons. Burn the enemy. Burn them. Send them to hell. How did that, Jack?
Thank you, dear. I love women with guns, and you're one of the best. I'm happy to serve with you in this war against the Antichrist forces. Talk to you later. Okay. Wow. This gal, Cleon, in Washington State is something else.
President Vladimir Putin criticized U.S. plans to deploy missile defense to space weapons and opposing the development of the leadership in America today. They blew up 3,000 of our own systems.
Όταν ο συνταγματάρχης Γκράιτς έφυγε από το Άινταχο, ο Μακλάμ έδωσε στην κοινότητα το όνομα «Τα Περιστέρια της Κοιλάδας». Εκείνο το βράδυ, τα περιστέρια της Κοιλάδας συγκεντρώθηκαν σε αυτή την αίθουσα στην Πολυκάμια για να ακούσουν το λόγο του Θεού από τα χείλη του πάστορα.
No peace to him that went out, no peace to him that come in. And what was it? Nation destroyed nation and city against city? All of these wars and all these fightings, it's interesting, the next part of that verse said, for God did vex them with all adversity. Who was behind sending all of that adversity? It was God.
Όλοι τους ανήκουν στη σέκτα των λεγόμενων Identity Christians. Μια ομάδα ευαγγελιστών, ιδιαίτερα δημοφιλής στους κύκλους της ακροδεξιάς, των υποστηρικτών της Αρίας Φυλής και των αντικυβερνητικών κινημάτων στην Αμερική.
There is no place of safety. Fires, droughts, floods, weather-related problems. Listen, we were in a drought in Georgia for months. We went probably 2 to 3 months without any rain during the growing season. And yet in Texas, they were flooding. I hope you know that God is in control of the weather.
Παραστρατιωτικοί, ρατσιστές και λάτρεις της επιβίωσης συνιστούν ένα ετερόκλητο σύνολο. Του συνδέει η πίστη, αν όχι η έμονη ιδέα ότι είναι εξαιρετικά πιθανή μια μεγάλη φυσική καταστροφή, ανθρώπινη ή θεϊκή. Μια ιδιότυπη εκδοχή της Αποκάλυψης.
This house was built by a guy named Mike Molesworth. He's a retired truck driver. And he was listening to the radio and over the CBs. He got to talking with people down in Nevada, and they started talking about places where they could go to be Christians and prepare for the end times. It's part of their belief. It's important to some Christian groups to prepare for the time when Armageddon comes. And that was Mr. Molesworth's idea. He put himself a bunker in there. He's got enough food to last 3.5 years. A cistern with thousands of gallons of water inside the bunker, and another cistern outside the bunker, and a little 2-foot escape hatch that he could get out if he needed to. But basically, he was settled down for the end times. The razor wire, he says, is for when the end times show up. You want to have your garden there, but you don't want your neighbors coming to steal from your garden.
Πριν από λίγες μέρες, ο ιδιοκτήτης αυτού του σπιτιού έβαλε πολιτήριο στην είσοδο. Και εξαφανίστηκε.
He just said it was taxes. Mm-hmm. He ended up with a felony. In the United States, if you get a felony, you lose your right to own guns. And he wanted to own guns. He believes that you need a gun to protect yourself.
Το παζάρι των όπλων στη Μιζούλα, μια μικρή κομμόπολη στη γειτονική πολιτεία της Μοντάνα, συγκεντρώνει κάθε φορά περισσότερους από 2.000 επισκέπτες. Από τους πάγκους θα μπορούσε να εξοπλιστεί ένα ολόκληρο στρατιωτικό τάγμα.
Best sellers right there. AR-15, semi-automatic, AP-4 configuration. Got the knockout for the grenade launcher. Of course, you can't have a grenade launcher, but people like it. The next best thing would be the the AKs. Everybody loves an AK right now. I'm all out of them except for the heavy barrel. Mm-hmm. That's the last one I got right at the moment.
I would venture to say in Montana, you know, that the average home, firearms owner home probably has a good strong dozen firearms at least. And it goes up from there. I mean, I've been in so many homes with collections in the hundreds of firearms. The Second Amendment here in the United States, it guarantees the citizens the right to keep and bear arms, quite simply.
Η αγορά της Μιζούλα διαθέτει όπλα και πυρομαχικά, ακόμη και για τους πιο απαιτητικούς πελάτες. Από τους κυνηγούς, ως τους οπαδούς της επιβίωσης.
I think that every one of us, to some extent, is a bit of a survivalist. You know, we manage to get through life and, you know, by being alert and aware of what's going on around us.
Σε αυτή την περιοχή της Αμερικάνικης Δύσης, σου δημιουργείται η εντύπωση ότι ακόμη και τα παιδιά παίζουν με πραγματικά όπλα.
The problem that we're facing in this country is in our school systems. You know, the kids are being taught within the school systems that guns are a bad deal, and the teachers are losing track of what the Second Amendment is all about. So as the, you know, as these kids are coming up through the ranks and the generations are changing, we're seeing less and less interest in the young kids coming up through into the, you know, into the gun scene. So we're, you know, we're trying to get this thing turned around as much as we possibly can. As a promoter, I mean, I don't charge anything for kids to come into the shows. Here in Montana, we have a hunter education program. I allow free admission for any of the kids that go through a hunter education program.
I would say that firearms in the United States ensure the rest of our liberties, ensure the rest of our rights. I mean, all it would take would be an onerous government that decides that it doesn't no longer trust its citizens to probably have a replay of a number of former, you know, conflicts, Civil War being the last one.
Colonel Bo Greitz here. Welcome to Spike, specially prepared individuals for key events.
Ο βετεράνος των ειδικών δυνάμεων και ιδρυτής της κοινότητας στο Άινταχο προετοιμάζει κάποιους Αμερικανούς για πόλεμο από το 1993. Το λεγόμενο Spike Training είναι ένα στρατιωτικό πρόγραμμα εκπαίδευσης διάρκειας 96 ωρών που απευθύνεται σε απλούς πολίτες.
What you're going to learn from Delta Force qualified personnel are exactly the techniques and methods that the elite of the CIA, their counter-terrorist teams, and the elite of the FBI, the hostage response team, and Delta Force are taught.
To me, a spike is something that you drive in to hold something together when something is trying to tear it apart. So I thought, all right, my people are going to be spikes. They're going to be prepared to go deep and hold things together. The idea is that you're prepared for all of this so that no matter what the challenge is, it's like special forces. Mm-hmm. It's kind of a MacGyver type thing.
We're teaching you to be a teacher. I want you to share what you get here. That's the idea. You get your fire lit right here, then you go out and light as many fires as you can.
We had 12 phases. I went to 12 cities across the United States. It took me 42 months with the idea that anyone that would stick with me could be as qualified as anybody that put on a green beret. without all the 100 different ways, you know, to pull your guts out of your ears or something without use of a weapon.
You're going to shoot several times. You're not just going to go bang one shot and hope that you hit a control center. That's not the way it works. You ever seen a knife fight like they have in prisons? They don't just come up and do this dueling stuff. What they do is they get up to you and they dag you a whole bunch of times because they try to put a lot of holes in you so you leak a lot.
Μια πιο προσεκτική ματιά στο πρόγραμμα αρκεί για να ανακαλύψει κανείς ένα σωρό αμφιλεγόμενα μαθήματα για απλούς πολίτες εν καιρό ειρήνης. Όπως για παράδειγμα πώς να πείτε ψέματα στο τεστ της αλήθειας και να ξεγελάσετε το μηχάνημα. Πώς να χειρουργήσετε σοβαρά τραύματα από σφαίρες πυροβολού όπλου. Ή πώς να οδηγήσετε το αυτοκίνητό σας για να ξεφύγετε από ένα μπλόκο.
Welcome to the Delta Counter-Terrorist Driving portion of Spike 10.
Ένα από τα πιο χρήσιμα κεφάλαια της εκπαίδευσης, σύμφωνα με τον Bob Graitz, είναι και η κατασκευή αυτοσχέδιων εκρηκτικών μηχανισμών.
We show you every conceivable way in the world to blow up something that is on four wheels. We are not teaching you to be car bombers. We are teaching you to be security specialists.
We didn't teach them the raids, the ambushes, this kind of thing. We taught them the confidence and the readiness skills of special forces.
Double taps on both targets, engage those targets. Now. Find your two targets.
One may say that you prepare your people for war.
That's not really true. If I prepared them for war, which I certainly prepared over a dozen nationalities, I would intensify their training in knife fighting, in use of force multipliers like the Afghans, in all kinds of ways to mine and booby trap and snipe. But instead of that, what we did is we taught defense against edged weaponry, defense against firearms, and because we were teaching civilians not to be victims.
What I thump is going up to the individual and thumping them in the eye with your finger. If the individual reacts, he's alive. If he doesn't react, he is most likely dead.
How many people did you train?
About 5,000.
I want to congratulate you. Having finished Phase 8, if you have the other videotapes or you've completed the training, then you're qualified for Special Forces.
A lot of good police officers and soldiers that are going to be told that we are the enemy of their nation. We are Al-Qaeda. We are, you know, we are the domestic terrorists and they should come kill us. And because they don't know the truth, they're going to come kill us, or we're going to kill them. And so that's so sad to me, it just about makes me want to cry. I fear soon we'll either win this or we're going to lose it, and the war will start.
I want to be standing beside America. I praised God last night, night before, for letting me be a special forces soldier and letting me be a commander and letting me lead troops in combat in these special operations. The psychiatrists will say, Bo, you're obsessed with all this stuff and you're an addict. There is some truth to that.
Are you afraid of?
I'm not afraid of anything. That's true. So far, I've had something to do, so I've been a survivor.
Thank you.